our communities ought to be better places and different places because our churches are there. However, you know as I know that by default, a church will draw inward rather than focusing outward to the community. So in light of that, it's my strong belief that every church ought to have a very intentional plan birthed in prayer for how they're going to reach out to and connect with their community. And of course, our ultimate desire is to share the gospel with people. We want to see people come to faith in Jesus Christ, disciple making, multiplication of disciples. But typically, we need to love before we get the opportunity to proclaim. We need to build relational bridges that will sustain the weight of the gospel. Healthy churches multiply, so we want to help all of our churches get healthier. We want to multiply disciples, workers, and leaders so that we can multiply churches, and in so doing, placing new gospel presence in communities, whether that community is defined geographically or ethnically.
Good morning. Wow. 1, 2, 3, 4. What is going on? Well, I have no idea why that's crackling. We want to welcome you. I don't know. Yeah, so just a couple announcements. Number one, we're glad you're here. And I believe if you're here for the 100th time or for the first time, I want to say that God has you here for a purpose today. This isn't just another Sunday. You are here by God's design. And yeah, we're going to have some announcements, singing, sermon. I just want you to know that God's got you here for a reason. I don't know exactly what that is, but I pray as we make our time throughout the service today that the Lord will speak to you and you will receive the message that he has for you. Just a couple of quick announcements. I don't know if we can try and get these around. The nursery sign up. Yikes. I'll come back there when I'm done with the announcements. We're looking for more nursery workers, and if you'd be willing and available for that, we'd appreciate you signing up and helping out with that. Saturday night, we're going to have a pie night, 5 o'clock here at the church. Not only are we going to have chicken pot pie, we're going to have various pies for dessert, and there's also some fun brain teasers. So even if your brain isn't really functioning at that time, come and enjoy the food and the fellowship. 5 o'clock here at the church. Pie night. Bunch of other announcements. I'll let you take a read through those. The last one I want to make you aware of is each week we're trying to bless a different group or entity in our community. And this week as a church, we want to lift up the Sydney Lutheran Brethren Church. They're up on the hill there. They got the big cross that's lit up every night. We want to pray for God's blessing, love and leading and unity to be poured out on the staff and the congregation up there. So if you can try and remember that throughout the week to pray a blessing over the Lutheran Brethren Church, pretty sure they would appreciate it. And I don't know if we get this message enough, but we really are on the same team. They're not our competitors. We are brothers and sisters in Christ, and we want to support them. So if you'll bow your heads and pray with me as we begin here. Father God, it is a blessing to be here today, and like I started off, I believe we're here by your design. Whether that's our first time here or our 101st time, Lord, you have a message for us today. We want to receive that. We want to lean into that. We want your Holy Spirit to be present here to guide our time together. And I pray, God, we'll have ears to listen to you. And on this day as well, Lord, we pray for the Lutheran Brethren Church. May your blessing be upon them. May they be united in spirit and in purpose. And may they do their part as we seek to do our part to further your kingdom in Sydney and beyond. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Good morning. We're glad that you're here this morning. And I would like to read some good things from the scripture, God's word. In 1 Corinthians chapter 2, starting in verse 12, it says, "We have not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit who is from God, that we may understand what God has freely given us. This is what we speak, not in words taught by human wisdom, but in words taught by the Spirit, expressing spiritual truths in spiritual words. The man without the Spirit does not accept the things that come from the Spirit of God, for they are foolishness to him, and he cannot understand them, because they are spiritually discerned. The spiritual man makes judgments about all things, but he himself is not subject to any man's judgment. For who has known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? But we have the mind of Christ." And this is good news, because sometimes I don't feel like I have the mind of Christ, but God has given us his Spirit, and that is good news. And I want us to think about that as we sing our first song together, and would you stand with us as we sing together this morning?
Sweetest.
offering.
I'm going to just ask you to bow your heads and pray along with me. Yeah, Father God, what a blessing to know that you are a great God. Father God, I would pray for the people we know that don't yet know you, Lord, that the eyes of their hearts could be opened up. They too would be able to join us in worship here on earth as well as in heaven for all eternity. Father God, we pray not only for our nation, we pray for the world right now who is so stressed out and in fear of this coronavirus. Lord, I pray that through this you're going to show yourself to be faithful. I pray for your healing upon all those who have contracted this virus. Lord, let this be a time for the Church of Jesus Christ to stand up and to minister graciously and effectively here and around the world. Protect our workers that are in the midst of this virus. And God, I pray for us. This is a reminder. We do not have to live in fear. You're on the throne. Everything is under your control at all times. Lord, let us live for you and to make the most of every opportunity you give us right here in Sydney, Montana. Father God, I am asking for your blessing upon the tithes and offerings that are collected, those that have already been sent in with e-giving. Lord, we want to see your kingdom grow here. We want to see it more people, not just in church, God, but in a relationship with you. And we know there's far too many people right here that are without Christ and therefore without hope. So God, help us to invest these resources wisely to further your kingdom here and around the world. And we ask for your continued blessing on our time together this morning. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Consecrated, Lord, to thank you that you forgive us and you redeem us and that you make us holy, that you are our righteousness, Jesus. And yet it's not because of things that we have done, but by your great mercy which you have poured out on us. Thank you, Jesus, that you keep pouring it out on us, God. Thank you, God, for taking all of our sin and all of our shame. And Lord, when we don't give you our hands and our feet and our mouth and our will, as we sang before, I pray that you would help us to acknowledge that and repent of that, God, and help us to come humbly before you, God. Lord, thank you that you don't give up on us, and it's not a one-shot deal with you, God. Thank you that you are constant, even though we are not. Thank you that you are faithful, even when we are not, God. Thank you that you are trustworthy and that you are full of integrity, even when we are not. And we worship you and we come before you and say, you are the Savior, Jesus, that there is no other way for us to be saved. We praise you, God. Thank you for doing miracles in our lives and in our hearts and in our minds, and that you're still at work. Thank you, God.
This is my confidence.
I'm going to ask you to turn to the back of your bulletin. There is hopefully a prayer that you've prayed a time or two. If not, this might be your first time. The Lord's Prayer. And I'm going to ask, I know you just sat down, but I'm going to ask you to stand up. And we are going to recite this together, the Lord's Prayer. I'm going to ask you to say this out loud with me. So, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Interestingly enough, there are two more verses that I didn't get printed on the bulletin that will really pertain to the message this morning. So right after that, and this is Jesus Christ responding to the disciples, and they're asking him, Lord, teach us how to pray. And we just prayed the prayer that we now call the Lord's Prayer. And after that, Jesus says, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. I believe one of the most crippling, one of the most damning, respectable sins that we as followers of Jesus Christ commit and or permit in our lives is a sin of unforgiveness. When we do not forgive those who sin against us, we are most certainly not following the example of our Lord Jesus Christ. In the book of Colossians, the Apostle Paul writes, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. Forgiveness is the core of the gospel. And as followers of Christ, I know that we are really quick to claim the promise of 1 John 1:9. 1 John 1:9, anybody know it from memory? If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. We relish the truth that when we confess our sins to Jesus Christ, he forgives them. And that word forgive means to wipe out, to cleanse, to remove. It means that he does not hold against us our sins. In fact, there's a verse in the Bible that says when we confess our sins, he removes those sins from us as far as the east is from the west. And this is a good thing, is it not? That we can relish in the truth that Jesus Christ forgives all of our sins. And when we confess to Jesus Christ, no matter what our sin or sins may be, the promise, the truth of God's word is, I'll wipe it away, I'll cleanse you from it, I forgive you, I wipe it clean. I'm not going to hold it against you. That, I am saying, is the core of the gospel. However, when someone happens to say something to us or do something to us that we don't necessarily appreciate or is outright sin against us, we're not so quick to extend the same forgiveness that we have received from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Some of us like to nurse the grudge. We want to make sure the other person understands how much they've hurt us. We want to make sure other people are aware that we've been mistreated, that we've been sinned against. We want to make sure sometimes that the people who sin against us pay for the hurt that they've caused us. And I am of the conviction that this behavior, this attitude, is literally smothering the life and the witness of Christ in our lives, in our church, and in our community. So I want you to look again at the back of your bulletin, and I'm asking, do we really mean it when we say, Father, forgive us our sins, our trespasses, as we forgive us our sins, as we also have forgiven those who have sinned against us? I'm asking this, do we really want Jesus Christ to forgive us the way we forgive others? Or would a better translation of this go something like this? Father, forgive us our sins, even when we are not willing to forgive those who sin against us. Seriously, do you ever wonder why Jesus added those words at the end of the Lord's Prayer, which to me I wish would have been part of the, what's the word, when we recite it, that should have been included, not just stopping after forever and ever, amen, but to go on, for if you forgive men when they sin against you, your heavenly Father will also forgive you, but if you do not forgive men their sins, your Father will not forgive your sins. Forgiveness is a big deal to God, like a big deal to God. Not only that, it's a big deal for Him to extend it to us, it's a big deal for us to extend it to others. I'm going to ask if you would turn in your Bible to Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18, I'm going to start out in verse 21. Interestingly enough, this comes in the context of Matthew 18, where Jesus is teaching on how to be reconciled, how to be at peace with people who have sinned against you. And he goes on to tell a parable of the lost sheep. How many times? We're going to pick it up in verse 21. Just right before this, they're asking, how many times are we to... Oh, I'm sorry. Verse 21. Right? Matthew 18, verse 21. So keep in mind here that Jesus is talking to his disciples. Right? This isn't the crowd. This is his disciples. Peter came to Jesus and asked, Lord, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Up to seven times? Jesus answered, I tell you, not seven times, but 77 times. Therefore, the kingdom of heaven is like a king who wanted to settle accounts with his servants. As he began the settlement, a man who owed him 10,000 talents. That's like a couple million dollars, right? More money than you and I will probably ever see. A lot of money. Was brought to him. Since he was not able to pay the master, the master ordered that he and his wife and his children and all that he had be sold to repay the debt. The servant fell on his knees before him. Be patient with me, he begged, and I will pay back everything. The servant's master took pity on him, canceled the debt, and let him go. But when that servant went out, he found one of his fellow servants who owed him 100 denarii, like a few bucks. Okay, he's just been released of a couple million-dollar debt. Now he's saying, fellow servant owed him a couple bucks. He grabbed him and began to choke him. Pay back what you owe me, he demanded. His fellow servant fell to his knees and begged, be patient with me, and I will pay you back. Is that not the exact words that he used? But he refused. Instead, he went off and had the man thrown into prison until he could pay the debt. When the other servants saw what had happened, they were greatly distressed and went and told their master everything that had happened. Then the master called the servant in. You wicked servant, he said. I canceled all that debt of yours because you begged me to. Shouldn't you have had mercy on your fellow servant just as I had on you? In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers to be tormented until he should pay back all he owed. And this is a verse, this next one, we need to pay attention to. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother from your heart. That's Jesus Christ talking. And he's talking to his followers, his disciples. And he's saying, this is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of you, and by extension, each of you are those of us who are proclaiming faith in Christ. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat each of you unless what? Unless you forgive your brother from your heart. I don't know how you read that or understand that, but to me it's screaming that God really does not like it. God doesn't, he's infuriated when we are quick to receive his forgiveness and yet hesitant to extend that same forgiveness to others. I just want you to look at a couple of other verses, a couple other passages of Scripture saying basically the same thing, right? If you do not forgive men their sins, this is a different thing of what we just read from the Lord's Prayer. If you do not forgive men their sins, what does the rest of it say? Your Father, God, will not forgive your sins. We just read this one. In anger, his master turned him over to the jailers until he should pay back all he owed. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat you. This is how my Heavenly Father will treat you, me, unless we forgive our brothers or sisters from the heart. Again, this is a word of Jesus Christ himself. Mark 11, Jesus again speaking says, when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive him so that your Father in heaven may forgive you your sins. And lastly, in James, judgment without mercy will be shown to anyone who has not been merciful. Mercy triumphs over judgment. This is only a handful of verses, but are you getting the idea that forgiveness is a big deal to God? This is a big deal to God. And here, I want you to jot this one down. We are the most forgiven people. We should be the most forgiving people. We are the most forgiven people. We should be the most forgiving people. So having received God's forgiveness, we are now to extend forgiveness to others when they sin against us. And mark my word, you already experienced this in your life multiple times. People will sin against you. Brothers and sisters in Christ will sin against you. It's going to happen. Don't act surprised when it does. Not to forgive others when they sin against us would mean, if I'm reading these scripture right, would mean that we have not received forgiveness ourselves. This is why I think this is so important. When we are hesitant to extend forgiveness to others, it is a warning that we have yet to receive God's forgiveness. And here's why I say that. Because Scripture is teaching if we withhold forgiveness from others, it is saying that we have yet to receive forgiveness from God. And I think many of us are under the impression that because we've prayed some prayer or because we've gone to church or read our Bibles or fill in the blank, that we've been forgiven. That we're in right relationship with God. And if this passage in Matthew 18 tells us anything, if we are like that servant who is saying he's been, and he had, the servant was released of his debt and yet goes out and demands payment from somebody for a few dollars, the master said, I'm taking you to prison. You're not getting out. In other words, that debt that I canceled of yours, it isn't canceled. Because you didn't extend the grace that I had given you. This really is serious stuff, like serious. We have a choice to make. We can extend forgiveness to those who sin against us, or like the unmerciful servant in Matthew 18, we can refuse to forgive others and suffer the consequences. There's an insert in your bulletin. I would ask you to take it out. It's the Peacemaker brochure. Right? Looks like that on the front. I want you to flip it around to the very, very back page. The very back page. It's got the seven A's of confession on top. It's got the four promises of forgiveness in the middle and the pause principle on the bottom. You on that page? Right? Let me help you, help myself here. Here's how you know if you've forgiven someone. Because here's what we're taught in the church, right? If you spend any amount of time in the church, had any Bible influence in your life, we're taught to forgive, right? Because we've been forgiven by Christ, we are to extend that forgiveness to others. Here's the four promises. When you say, I forgive you for, this is what it means, that you're not going to dwell on it. You're not going to bring it up and use it against the other person. You're not going to talk about this incident to others, that meaning in a bad way to bring the other person down. You're not going to allow this incident to stand between us or hinder our personal relationship. So those are the four promises of forgiveness. And here's why I want you to see this. I want you to hang on to this brochure. I want you to use it, read through the whole brochure. It's chock full of great peacemaking, reconciliation, insight, materials, teaching. Why I'm sharing this with you is we have got to be careful, very careful, that we do not mouth empty, meaningless words of, I forgive you, right? And we don't mean it. I think that does more damage than not saying anything at all. So the question is, well, how do I know if I've forgiven so-and-so? How do I know if I've said it, right? Because that's what the pastor says, that's what the Bible teaches, but I find myself dwelling on it. I find myself bringing this up and using it against that person again and again. I am talking to others about it, and I am dragging that other person through the mud. And it does hinder our relationship. So these are clues. These are those lights on the dash of your vehicle saying, you know what? There's something wrong. There's something wrong under the hood. Yes, you've mouthed the words, I forgive you. But you keep thinking about it. You talk to others. You keep using it against them. And you are allowing this to stand between us, between you and the other person, and hinder your personal relationship. So check this out with me. You've said you've forgiven a brother or sister, forgiven somebody outside the church. Maybe it's in your own family. I hope this doesn't apply to this. But how do you know if you've forgiven? This is just one example. You may think it's pretty corny, but I think it tells a lot. You're in the grocery store, you're walking down the whatever aisle, and there's that person that you said, you mouthed the words, I forgive you, yet what do you do when you see them? That's a warning sign to you that you have not forgiven them. We got to be very careful with this one. This respectable sin that we've allowed, that we've coddled in our lives, in the church. Don't fall into the trap of mouthing empty words, I forgive you, and not mean it. And when or if any of these come up again after you've said you've forgiven somebody, this is a warning light. This is God's grace being extended to you and saying, you know what? You got another shot at this. You got another shot. Let me tell you something, why this is affecting the witness of us as followers of Christ. I just heard it the other day. I forget the guy's name. He's a politician. He made some not-so-nice remarks about two of the Supreme Court justices. 2 days later, he made an apology, a confession. It was so, thank you, weak. I don't know if he said if in there or but it was so like, I'm sorry they understood it that way, but you got to understand. What does that mean then? Again, we're in church. It's bulk. For us, as followers of Christ, to demonstrate the gospel in real life, there is not going to be much of a stronger witness than us extending forgiveness to people who sin against us. This is otherworldly. This is not the way the world operates. This is a God thing. Forgiveness is a God thing. You will not be able to forgive somebody on your own. Mark my word. You'll mouth empty words. This is going to keep happening. You're going to keep dwelling on it. You're going to bring it up to use it against them. You're going to talk to others about it. And you will allow it to stand between you and that person. Mark my word. Without God in it. But when God is in it, it's you release the consequences. You release the debt to Christ. He'll take care of it. He is a just God. He's a loving God. He'll figure it out. Part of this unforgiveness is our struggle with control. We want to make sure the other person hurts as bad as we do, or we want to make sure other people see that person the way we see them. And that is not the way God wants his followers to act. This is not easy. The closer the relationship, the more the hurt, the harder it is to extend forgiveness. We, as Christ followers, have an opportunity to demonstrate the kingdom of God here on earth, just like it is in heaven, by extending forgiveness to people who sin against us. And if we do not, the teaching of the Bible, the teaching of Jesus Christ is pretty clear. If we do not extend forgiveness, we are blocking the reception then of God's forgiveness towards us. And I, for one, do not want to be in that position. I don't want you to be in that position. So I'm going to ask you to stand. And we are going to recite the Lord's Prayer again. And I pray that we see it and say it in a different way than we did 20 minutes ago. So let us pray, and again, let us say this out loud together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is a kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. This is such a simple example. To say, Lord, I forgive the person. Say their name. Four, specify the sin. Because every time we confess our sins to Jesus Christ, he is faithful and just and he will forgive us. Let us then model Christ. Let us model the kingdom of heaven here on earth by extending that same forgiveness to others. Easy? No way. Powerful? You better believe it. God wants to demonstrate his kingdom through you. My conviction is this is one of the most powerful ways you can demonstrate the kingdom of God in this world, in this community, extending forgiveness to those who have sinned against you. You up for the challenge? Because it is a challenge. Let me pray for you. Father God, this is a big deal, this forgiveness. I pray, God, that we can get it, that we can apply it, that we of all people, the most forgiven, we need to be the most forgiving. We cannot do this on our own. We need you. We need your grace. We need your strength. We need your mercy. Will you please help us to demonstrate the kingdom of God here in Sydney by enabling and empowering us to extend forgiveness to those who have sinned against us. We want to do this for your glory. It is for our good. I know it is. It's also for the benefit of those who have sinned against us. Help us to reflect you throughout this week by extending forgiveness to those who sin against us. We ask and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. That's my benediction. Go in peace. Remember, we got the different life groups available for kids all the way through adults. You're invited to take part in those. Thank you.